back in order. Since 2012, Somalia devoted the bulk of its energies and very limited resources in what is to critical domestic concerns, including rebuilding public institutions and safeguarding the security of our people. While there remains much that to be done, we have made substantial progress. Rebuilding our house also means tending to our fences with our neighbors. We hoped that it would be possible to settle our dispute with Kenya bilaterally through negotiations. Unfortunately, that proved impossible. Our respective views were too different and too firmly held. That is why we are here today before you. Unfortunately, some of our brothers and sisters in Kenya appear to misinterpret our actions. There are those who view Somalia's decision to initiate and pursue these proceedings as an unfriendly act. For example, at that time, these oral proceedings were initially scheduled to begin. The majority and minority leaders of the Kenyan National Assembly tabled a motion to, among other things, call on the government of Kenya to D, express to the United Nations the Republic of Kenya's protest against the assertion of jurisdiction by the International Court of Justice over the maritime boundary conflict between Federal Republic of Somalia and the Republic of Kenya. And E, explore other lawful and constitutional mechanisms for protecting the territory of the Republic, including deploying the Kenya Defense Forces to the subject boundary to undertake the responsibility of protecting the sovereignty and territorial integrity of the Republic. We understand that passions about border issues are easily inflamed, but the matter of delimitation of the maritime boundary between Somalia and Kenya has been entrusted to the judgment of this most distinguished court. The Charter of the United Nations compels all member states to resolve their disputes by peaceful means, including by judicial settlement. By presenting its application, initiating this case, after negotiations failed, Somalia was carrying out an objective of the Charter by seeking judicial settlement of a dispute that the parties were unable to achieve on their own. And the court itself confirmed the priority of Somalia's recourse to judicial settlement when it agreed that it had jurisdiction over the case. This is as it should be, Madam President, because only with the court's assistance can the impasse be broken, a settlement be found, and legal certainty delivered. We are therefore deeply concerned that Kenya has decided not to appear at these hearings. In Somalia's view, this is inconsistent with Kenya's obligations under the Charter, the statute, and rules of the court. And as a party subject to the jurisdiction of the court in these proceedings, it is also inconsistent with respect for the rule of law. Certainly, Kenya has no grounds to complain about its treatment by the court. Indeed, in Somalia's view, the court has been generous in accommodating Kenya. It granted three requests from Kenya to postpone these hearings for a total of 18 months. It allowed Kenya to submit more than 4 pages of new documents on the eve of these hearings, more than 2 years after the written pleadings in this case closed. The court even allowed Kenya to submit a 315-page supplemental legal pleading, which is not contemplated by the rules, barely 10 days before the start of the hearings. Kenya thus has been afforded due process in abundance. Fortunately, it is a regrettable decision to boycott the oral hearings cannot prevent them from proceedings, nor can Kenya's defiance prevent the court from fulfilling its mission. And after taking account of both parties' voluminous submission and duly deliberating on them, rendering a final judgment that is final and binding on both parties, which establishes a definitive and permanent maritime boundary between our two states. That judgment is critical to Somalia because it will enable us to secure access to the maritime resources to which the law entitles us, resources that are potentially some of Somalia's most valuable assets. It's vital to ensuring the future stability and prosperity of our nation. Those resources will play a major role in assuring Somalia's continued development in a way that benefits all our people. Madam President, on the merits, this case is actually quite straightforward. Both Somalia and Kenya are parties to the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. The court has developed a rich jurisprudence interpreting and applying the provisions of the convention regarding the delimitation of maritime boundaries. In case after case, the court has applied the three-step method, and it has now become standard practice. This begins with the drawing of equidistance line from the land boundary terminus. Fortunately, there are no technical, geographical, or other impediments to the construction of the equidistance line from that point. The second step of the process is the examination of the coastal geography for relevant circumstances that might warrant an adjustment to the equidistance line. In Somalia's view, there are none. The coastline is entirely regular, without any anomalous features, and there are no offshore features that distort the equidistance line. The final step of the process is to assess whether significant disproportionality results from the equidistance line. As we have shown in our written pleadings, there is none. There is thus no reason to depart from or adjust the equidistance line. In Somalia's view, the equidistance line is the equitable solution that the law requires. Kenya, of course, would have it differently. It urges the court to depart from the approach followed in every recent maritime delimitation case by adopting as the boundary a line that follows a parallel of latitude rather than an equidistance line. Kenya's main argument is that Somalia has acquiesced in such a line. Madam President, Somalia has never agreed or acquiesced that the boundary should follow a parallel of latitude. Our council today will elaborate on what Somalia definitively showed in its written pleadings. Maritime boundaries cannot, as a matter of law, be established through acquiescence. But even if this were possible under the law, it could not be the case here because the facts demonstrate that Somalia never acquiesced to Kenya's unilateral claim that the boundary was the parallel of latitude. Kenya's argument that the court should adopt the parallel of latitude as the boundary, even if Somalia never acquiesced in such a line, to reach this conclusion, Kenya would have the court dispense with the three-step method. Instead of that standard method, Kenya, in its own words, asks the court to apply a quote parallel of latitude delimitation methodology, end quote. This is not a methodology that has ever been recognized, let alone applied by the court or by any other international court or arbitral tribunal. We cannot help but believe that it has been invented by Kenya. It is made in Kenya for the sole purpose of justifying its claim. It's an obvious contrivance that puts the cart before the horse. It presupposes Kenya's desired outcome, and it is highly prejudicial to Somalia. As such, it fails to produce an equitable solution as the law requires. Madam President, Kenya has not only claimed an extensive maritime area on Somalia's side of the equidistant line, but has also sought to exploit it. In particular, Kenya has authorized exploration activities, including seismic testing and drilling a well in the maritime zone claimed by Somalia. Somalia considers that these activities in a disputed area violate UNCLOS and customary international law. In its written pleadings, Somalia called for full reparation, including compensation for these violations. But we have come before this court in a spirit of peace and goodwill, seeking neither vengeance nor retribution. In this spirit, we have decided not to insist on compensation for past violations of our maritime rights. Madam President, members of the court, it is now my honor to lay out the organization of Somalia's presentations. Following me to the podium this afternoon will be Professor Alain Pellet. He will address Kenya's errors of law on the issue of acquiescence. He will show that it is not possible to establish an international maritime boundary by unilateral action. In the absence of an express agreement or a judicial determination, the establishment of a maritime boundary requires, at very least, tacit agreement. This, Professor Pellet will explain, is an exceedingly high bar to meet, and one cannot be met in the circumstances of this case. Professor Philip Sanders, QC, will then show why the facts do not support a finding that Somalia acquiesced in Kenya's unilateral declaration of a maritime boundary. The record is replete with contradictions in Kenya's position, including statements Kenya made in oral hearings before the court more than 4 years ago. Members of the court who heard Kenya articulate its preliminary objections in September 2016 will recall that Kenya took the view that the boundary remained to be established, not that it had already been agreed or acquiesced to. The argument that Kenya made before you then is directly at odds with the argument it makes now that a maritime boundary came into existence by virtue of Somalia's acquiescence. Having shown that Kenya's acquiescence argument must fail, Somalia's counsel will demonstrate why the boundary should be delimited by the court's standard, three-step method, and why, in application of that method, an equidistant line is the equitable solution here. First, Professor Alain Mayron will lay out the law applicable to the judicial settlement of maritime boundary disputes. In particular, how international courts and tribunals follow the three-step method to achieve the equitable solution mandated by the 1982 Convention. She will show why Kenya has proffered no plausible, let alone sufficient, reason to deviate from the approach in this case. Next, Mr. Paul Reichler will explain how the standard three-step method leads to the conclusion that an equidistant line is the equitable solution here. He will show that the uncomplicated geographical circumstances relevant to this delimitation make the construction of a professional equidistance line unproblematic, and that there are no relevant circumstances meriting the adjustment of that line. He will also show that the solution produced by the adjusted equidistance line does not generate any disproportionality. And he will expose the fallacies in Kenya's approach to delimitation of the maritime boundary and the inequitable result that that approach produces. Finally, Mr. Edward Craven will show how Kenya has violated Somalia's sovereign rights and jurisdiction and breached its obligations under UNCLOS by authorizing and undertaking unilateral activities on Somalia's side of the equidistance line. That will conclude Somalia's first round. At the conclusion of Mr. Krafan's presentation, our assistant deputy agent, Mr. Mohamed Omar, will rise to deliver our closing remarks and read Somalia's final submissions. Madam President, members of the court, thank you for your time and courteous attention. I ask that now invite Professor Pellet to the virtual podium. Wallahu wali tawfiq, ni'ma al-mawla wa ni'ma al-nasir.
Premier Wallet wa application usub aw ku kanay Premier Bank. Faa'iidooyinka Premier Wallet waxa kamida waad iska diiwaan gelin kartaa adigoo jooga goobtaada. Dadkaana account ka ku lahayn bangiga Premier waa ay iska diiwaan gelin karaan Premier Wallet. Dukaamada iyo ganacsiyada kala duwan ayaad wax uga iibsan kartaa. Lacagaha waxbarashada, caafimaadka, korontada ayaad ku bixin kartaa. Lacag ayaad u diri kartaa qof kale, laguguna soo diri karaa si fudud. Account-kaaga iyo Mastercard-kaaga Premier Bank ayaad ku xiran kartaa, kana maamulan kartaa. Lacag ayaad ka dalban kartaa asxaabtaada ama waad ogolaan kartaa lacag laga soo dalbaday. Dhaqdhaqaaqa lacagahaagana waad kala socon kartaa. Ganacsiyadu waxa ay leeyihiin app u gaar ah oo ay kala socon karaan xogta lacag bixinta macaamiishooda. Inta ay in ka badanba ka hel appka Premier Wallet oo kala soo deg hadda Play Store-ka ama App Store-ka. Premier Wallet.